Okay, good morning everyone, and can I welcome to the 10th meeting of the Local Government and Communities Committee. Can I remind everyone present to turn off mobile phones, and as meeting papers are provided in digital format, tablets may be used by members during the meeting. That's my plea, honestly, that when you see us on digital devices, we're not on Twitter, we are looking at our briefing papers, we promise you. We have had an apology this morning from our Vice Convener, Elaine Smith. Unfortunately, she can't make it along this morning. We move to agenda item one, which is draft budget scrutiny 2017-2018, and our committee will take evidence from a number of witnesses on the Scottish Government's draft budget 2017-18. Given that the draft budget has yet to be published, the committee has agreed to undertake pre-budget scrutiny, looking back what has actually been spent in 2015-16 and to what extent possible in the year 16-17. Obviously, that's going to be more challenging to do. This is the first of two evidence sessions of pre-budget scrutiny. Today's evidence session was going to take place in a roundtable format. Our apologies, our last-minute change of heart in relation to that. Thank you very much, everyone, for coming along. So I'll run through who we have with us today. We have George Black, Visiting Professor, University of Strathclyde, Professor Richard Kerley, Professor of Management, Queen Margaret University, Councillor Michael Cook, Vice President, and Vicky Bibby, Chief Officer, Local Government Finance, COSLA, Eileen Howitt, Chief Executive, South Ayrshire Council, Solace Scotland, Councillor Frank McAvey, Leader, Glasgow City Council, and Morag Johnson, Executive Director of Financial Services, Glasgow City Council, representing Scottish Local Government Partnership, Kirsty Flanagan, Head of Strategic Finance, Argyll and Bute, we're almost there, and Alan Russell, Director of Finance and Resources, Renfrewshire Council. Thank you everyone for coming along. A couple of brief matters at the beginning, just to note that Professor Kerley may have to leave early, and he's intimated his apologies if he has to do that, and thank you for coming along. We understand that. We know the pressures on your time, and we're delighted to have Scottish Local Government Partnership and COSLA bring along some officials to give additional support on technical information. So thank you to Vicky Bibby and Morag Johnson for coming along to do that. But given the size of the panel in front of us, we're keen to have the elected representatives where possible to have that input, just to allow that kind of, if possible, with such a large panel, a zippiness in questions and scrutiny and answering and the like. So with the housekeeping over, we'll move to questions. And I'd really interesting read through the submissions, and it's clearly challenging financial times. And a couple of pressures identified in the papers was in relation to social work. It was a theme, and there was also budgetary pressures in relation to wage demands and staffing costs. And I noticed both of those as a theme, a number of themes running through the papers. Obviously, I'd like to link that to a theme, because we've got our own outcomes as a committee we are seeking to get from our budget scrutiny. One of the themes we've got is how we keep a track, not just of the Scottish Government revenue grant going to local authorities, but all the monies meeting the statutory duties of local authorities and all the monies in that local authority area. So we were particularly interested in the accountability around and the spending and direction of the Health and Social Care Integration Fund, which is £250 million a year, and other predecessor funds in relation to that. So in Glasgow, for example, that's seen a significant benefit in area around social work in relation to delayed discharge numbers, and there's been really good joint work in relation to that. So I'm just wondering how we track the monies, or how we should seek to track the monies in the future, and how those funds can help in relation to things like staffing costs. So the living wage for care staff was part of that £250 million. How we track that money and how you think that can assist or help local authorities meeting some of their statutory duties. Yes, Councillor Cook.
Okay, thanks, Chair. I'll come on to the question that you've asked, but I think it might be useful to start with some general propositions to begin with. So where are we coming from? We're coming from a position last year where local authorities saw a cut of 3.6% across the board. In real terms, that was 5.2%. That's a very significant cut to our budget, has very serious implications with regard to council services across the board. It certainly impacts on communities. I'm sure you've read the Spice report. You should be under no illusions about the impact, so much as local authorities are doing their damnedest to protect those who are further down the social and economic spectrum. because of the configuration of local government services, inevitably this impacts on those people and impacts on communities at large. Within that, you need to think about another number of considerations here. So it's not simply the level of cuts that we're now talking about, and it seems that the cut this year could be of the same order as last year, but actually it's the sheer inflexibility in the budget, and that will bring us on to things like the health and social care budget. So there are all sorts of restrictions in terms of how we as local government can spend our money. The most obvious of those are in relation to teacher numbers, the creation of an attainment fund.
Coming on to all of that,
okay.
But we did ask about pressures in social care and how integration funds feed into that. Whether, for example, you believe, you mentioned flexibility, would you rather that money, the £250 million, went to local authorities rather than to health boards? Because that,
yes.
I'm trying to tease out some
I'll
of that.
I'll tease that
we've
out.
Asked specifically in relation to
okay.
that. You'll have all the opportunities this morning to talk about these other issues, I can assure you, but we've asked a specific
right.
question there.
Let me come on to that then. The £250 million, the mechanism that was used for that last year was that the £250 million was directed through health, apparently to IJBs. I think it would be fair to say that councils generally were unhappy with that mechanism. There was no clarity about it, and effectively the whole of that resource was soaked up on the health side. It certainly didn't attenuate any of the cost pressures the councils were suffering from. And I think that's something that you need to understand. The proposition in relation to the living wage was something that was floated in very much at the last moment in terms of discussion with the Scottish Government. Now, that's not to say that local authorities aren't committed to that as an objective, but clearly there needs to be an understanding of the implications of such approaches. And frankly, if resource is being directed towards the living wage, then it doesn't attenuate other cost pressures, either in health and social care, and it certainly doesn't on the other side of the house. So effectively, the 3.6% cut that I was talking previously about in relation to local government services, that applied over the full spectrum of local government provision. The only attenuation that there was actually in health and social care with that 250 million, but a large chunk of that was used in relation to the living wage. The rest of it was used in relation to pressures there, and actually local authorities didn't really see any return on that other than the alleviation of pressures in that sector.
Can I just clarify that? Because my understanding is almost half of it was used in relation to living wage pressures. My apologies if I've got that number
125
wrong.
125 million.
So the vast majority wasn't used for health then, if half of it was used for living wage pressures. The point I'm trying to make is that local authorities were seeking to meet wage demands and pressures, which go beyond health and social care. I fully accept that.
Yes.
I'm trying to scrutinise the public pound that eventually found its way into wage responsibilities of local authorities and whether that has been helpful or not. And in relation to the other half of the £250 million, this is not chicken feed, Mr. Cook. There was co-sign-off in relation to that between local authorities and health boards. So you said it all went on health. That wasn't my understanding, but if you want to clarify and add on to those two
okay.
things, and then we'll take some other witnesses
yes.
in relation to that.
Notionally, the 250 million was split. So the 250 million was split between 125 that was supposed to be directed towards meeting those cost pressures associated with the living wage. The rest was, in theory, meant to attenuate cost pressures the local government had generally. That was the proposition as it was put to us in the negotiations with Scottish Government. What I'm saying to you is that the feedback from councils generally was that that was not how matters crystallised. So effectively, money was soaked up in relation to attenuating the costs of the living wage. The rest of it went in relation to cost pressures in health and social care, and any anticipated attenuation of general local government pressures did not accrue.
Right. Well, you know, Councillor Cook, we're not trying to make light of the cost pressures that local authorities are facing, and you will put all that in the record before us today. It's just maybe an acknowledgement that some of that money helped pay low-paid care staff in our communities better wages, and those were cost pressures mitigated by that money, and that money went to social work. But Councillor McAveety, could you help us out further?
And obviously, the question is a very effective question because we're trying to work out how the budget's allocated and who has responsibility for trying to meet the pressures that are there. Obviously, we've identified in our submissions, both the SLGP and COSLA, about the kind of core issues to do with the funding for local government to deliver much of the demands that are quite rightly there in terms of what our citizens expect, but also in terms of new measures that governments have had to identify that they want local government to be one of the vehicles to deliver it. In terms of the living wage, obviously, we were the first council in Scotland to advocate a living wage, and obviously part of our debate in Glasgow was to ensure that we tried to ensure the living wage would be part of the stuff. Now, there's still some tough decisions behind the scenes on that, convener, in terms of what do you do with the private sector in terms of their capacity to meet the needs of their staff in terms of living wage and the pressures they would have, that they would want the IGB resource allocation to meet just the pressures they have rather than necessarily the work commitment. In terms of the figures that we had for our IGB, and there's a fundamental structural issue of when you notify councils of that, and I've got to say, in terms of any recommendation I'd like to see would be a much earlier contribution about knowing exactly where the figures are. I think that was one of the concerns that we certainly had, because we were going through a budget process and we had a kind of dance of the seven veils around the budget about trying to work out what bits of it we could actually allocate to the pressures we had. I mean, in terms of figures I have available for Glasgow, and then obviously SLGP, it'll vary across the four authorities. £33 million was the element of the IGB resource allocation that was placed to the council, of which half of that had to meet the obligations around the living wage. The other half was about pressures in social work services. But we're still in the situation as we're developing the IGB, convener, where there are a number of issues that the health board are wanting to push down to IGBs that are very difficult decisions and very controversial decisions about community health provision. Maybe decisions that they should have been dealing with for a long time and chose either not to do it or couldn't do it because of the resources. So there's a big concern on that, and certainly our view as SLGP, and also my particular view as Glasgow Council leader, is that we really need to get much earlier clarity, and that's even the case, obviously, with the budget settlement, because we had anticipated we like to have gone for a budget in early December, but because there's not been any clarity yet at the Scottish level, it meant that's been delayed till probably early February. Hope that's helpful.
That's actually very helpful. In terms of the process, we want to be helpful to local authorities on how we can structure that process to make it easier for you to set your budgets, even though it's challenging circumstances. Mr Black, you'd indicated you wish to come in.
Just on the point you asked about how you could track the £250 million going to the integration authorities, I think that will become an even greater difficulty in the years ahead, because if the reform is to be truly successful, then the money that the councils put in and health put in will lose their identity as the integration takes place. So in the years ahead, I think if you were to look and say, has that integration been a success, part of that success would be that you wouldn't be able to track the money in the way that you can at the moment.
Which certainly makes this committee's job in tracking the public pound to scrutinise monies available for statutory local authority services challenging, which why I was so persistent, Councillor Cook, in relation to getting an idea of some of those monies. Would any other witnesses like to add to any of this discussion before I take in one of my colleagues for an additional question? Okay, thank you. Alexander.
Thank you very much, convener. You've touched on it, gentlemen, the earlier we get indication about where we're going with the finances from the Scottish Government and your own financial situation, the better. And we always seem to, over the last few years, be very much towards the end of the timescale, and we're all trying to run to get the budget out in time and make things happen. You may have done a lot of work in the past to try and put together some plans and formulate a strategy how you're going to go. But the pressures continually grow in the elderly section of the population, with a growing population and a growing elderly poor. And that seems to then take a large constraint on the services that we're all trying to provide. And at the blunt end of it, local governments suffer because they have to try and make that progress move forward. Now, can I just tease out a little bit? Well, when we're talking about that allocation of money that you get, how then do you prioritise that, ensuring that, is it the worst situation scenario gets the money first, or the ones that are showing the most pressure, or do you try still to align it to the areas you've put in place when you're doing your short-term and long-term financial management practice? Because if that is the case, then you're still managing to cope with the situation, or do you have to firefight as you move forward because of the lack of expenditure that you have left and the time scale and also the constraints with reference to the size and the ageing of population?
I think the simple answer is that you need to do all of those things. So clearly budget planning is an incredibly detailed and complex process. Local authorities have an obvious responsibility in relation to community planning partnerships. They've got a statutory responsibility in relation to that. They've got single outcome agreements. All of these are things which filter into the process in terms of working out what the priority spend is in relation to the resources that the local authority has available to it. At the same time, and I think this is the significance of the SPICE report, you can see that there are inordinate pressures on local authorities. And really, as I was trying to say, as a general proposition, that's really composed of two facets. So one of those is simply the level of reduction in resource. The second facet of that, which is composed of a number of elements, is simply the lack of flexibility that we have to deploy the resource in the way that we judge appropriate. And actually, I would say to you quite straightforwardly that generally speaking, when it comes to making budgetary decisions in local authority areas about what the priorities should be, people on the ground in those authorities are much better placed to make those judgments than our ministers. So that really is how things are unfolding. In terms of some of the difficulties that we have in turning around in our own skin, you have got obvious restrictions in relation to teacher numbers. So the reality of a teacher number requirement is it effectively locks up resource in terms of maintaining that number, or at least the proportion of teachers relative to the number of students across Scotland. That gives us considerably less flexibility in terms of how we employ that resource and is actually counterproductive to some of the aspirations of Scottish Government in terms of attainment, which are obviously shared by local authorities generally. So that's the nature of the problem. There's also a massive gearing effect. The gearing effect is such that if you make an across-the-board 5% cut, because of the level of protection that you've afforded to some discrete areas, then the effect of that cut is disproportionate in certain areas. So actually a bit of work that we've been looking at emerging from a particular local authority suggests that a 5% cut can amount to a 55% incursion into a particular service area. That's the level of the difficulty that we're dealing with. A related problem, obviously, is that local government, frankly, isn't the master of its own house in terms of how it works out its resource base. So we have no flexibility, for example, in relation to local taxation, and what taxation powers we have are being further restricted and, frankly, reutilized for national purposes rather than local purposes for which they were designed. Clearly, I'm referring to the multiplier and the creation of attainment fund, which will see resource drawn off from local authority areas and used to support a national policy. We don't bridle at the national policy. I think what we do bridle at is the fact that this drives a coach and horses through the principles of local taxation and completely trashes the democratic mandate of local authorities.
Thank you. Councillor McAvity?
Yeah. In terms of how to respond to it, I mean, I established in Glasgow, straight after we set our budget in March, a tackling austerity group, which meets every fortnight with the finance director and the chief executive and senior councillors to try and interrogate our budgets, to try and make ourselves at least as ready as we can be for whatever decisions are coming in terms of grant allocations. There is a structural issue, as I said earlier, about the relationship between central government and local government about the capacity to find allocation resources when much of it is predicated by either grant or preconditions in the grant. So, for example, last year's budget settlement essentially was a challenge for a number of authorities because we had to meet some of the kind of key priorities that the minister defined were the key priorities rather than the individuals at a local level who maybe would be, I would presume, know those communities the best that there can be on that. In terms of our reality though, is, I mean, we've got a 74 million gap emerging in Glasgow for the next financial year. The cumulative total includes 30 million for Renfrewshire, South Lancashire 35 and Aberdeen 44. So there's an incredible high figure of gap to be met. And even if there was flexibility around some of, not the issue around the issue of the allocation of the attainment fund, which is a debate for another committee and another time, and we will make our views known on that. Essentially, even if we have the flexibility of the 3% variation, you really are only talking about a tenth of the 74 million figure that Glasgow needs to find could even be funded from that. So there's a real scale issue, which I know that the committee members really need to interrogate. A more fundamental issue for us is that how do we actually recalibrate the debate that we need to have between ourselves, because I don't think there's much that separates ourselves in terms of ambitions for how to transform the communities that we represent. How do we actually pull together the levers at national level, both Scotland and the UK, and calibrate that with the kind of pressures that we know at local government level we need to respond to? So I think there's a genuine need for that to be opened up, and about who makes the decisions, what are the parameters of financial allocation, and also what we need to do in terms of local authorities.
Okay, thank you, Councillor McAfee. Before I take a supplementary in from Mr Simpson, would any other witnesses like to reply to that question? Mr Black.
You mentioned earlier about the severe financial challenges that lie ahead, and I think you could also add on to that the management of the new devolved tax powers, which will come into play. And it seems to me that there's a need for the budget process to evolve to take account of these factors and not continue as business as usual. And there's two issues I think would be helpful in terms of managing that. The first one is for, rather than decisions taken about how the cake is divided up and how much goes to local government, and then councils taking a view on their priorities, I think it would be more useful if local authorities were given planning assumptions by the Scottish Government, say, for example, what would be the impact of a 3, 4 or 5% reduction in grant, so that the Scottish Government could take account of issues like equality impact assessments, economic impact assessments, prior to making a decision about how much money goes to local government. And the second factor I think that could be managed would be to, instead of taking a one-year budget approach, would be to look at a one-year fixed budget followed by two-year indicative budgets, again to understand from councils what would be the impact of grant reductions over a longer period. And I think if the budget process was to evolve in that manner, that you would get, I think, better outcomes in terms of reducing inequality and increasing economic growth.
Okay, thank you very much. Councillor Cook, did you want to come back on some of that?
Yes, if I may. Obviously, the question that Mr Stewart asked was about timescales and planning in the context of the pressure of timescale. And I just wanted to make a couple of additional comments about that, which I hope might be useful. The first is, I suppose, self-evidently, the later that the budget is announced, that is a pressure in its own right, because it impacts upon the ability of local authorities to plan ahead. One thing that they do need to plan, and what Mr Black said about resource allocation and all of that, actually would assist this process. But in order to deliver transformative change, which local authorities are engaged in order to get budget fit, you need time to do that. You simply cannot do that in rapid, quick time, and certainly not on the back of a fag packet. So an added complication there is, of course, the propensity towards single-year financial settlements. That is a major problem for local government. What we want, really, is long-term planning so that we can see the topography ahead of us. And, of course, the single-year settlements that we had both last year and this year, it needs to be understood that these are a matter of a decision by Scottish Government. They could have decided to have a multi-year arrangement or a multi-year set of assumptions. They've chosen not to do that. I mean, far be it from me to suggest that the 2016 election may have been a consideration in terms of the single-year settlement last year, but again, we're going into a single-year settlement this year. That seriously complicates our ability to plan, which I'm sure Scottish Government, you want us to do, and we certainly want to be able to do.
Okay, thank you. Any other witnesses before we take Mr Simpson in? Okay. Graeme Simpson.
Thank you. It kind of does follow on from all that. Councillor McAveety, you've given some interesting figures of what you think Glasgow and other councils may have to cut, which will be news to Eddie McAvoy at South Lanarkshire. I speak as a South Lanarkshire councillor who's had a private paper on these figures, not for release, so thanks for revealing them. Have you been given the You've come up with these figures for yourself, so have you been given a kind of heads up from the Scottish Government? And my second question, which follows on from what you were saying, Councillor Cook, is there are a number of submissions from a number of you which are complaining about the centralised control of budgets and government applying conditions to the money that's given to councils. What would your plea be to the Scottish Government on that?
Just for anyone watching this who hasn't read the newspapers this morning, South Lanarkshire Council have said that they will freeze council tax for the next financial year. Just, Mr. Simpson, folk watching might not have been, their eyes may have been at other current events happening through the night. So yes, who would like to deal with those questions? I'm delighted to have Councillor Cook and Councillor McAveety answer these questions. I'm conscious there's a variety of witnesses here, but yes, Councillor Cook in the first instance.
I mean, I'm quite happy to answer questions all day long, really. In terms of the question about do we have a heads up, I'm slightly constrained in terms of what I can say about that, to the extent that clearly there is a negotiation process between COSLA and Scottish Government in relation to some elements of the budget. But I think it's safe to say that we do not know at this juncture what the level of the settlement will be that local government will receive. We certainly don't know that. And I think clearly if the Cabinet Secretary for Finance was challenged about that, he would be equally straightforward in terms of saying those figures have not been articulated. Clearly, local authorities are responding to a context in which they've read the Fraser-Vallander report, they've read a whole series of other stuff, they're making assumptions about how the world is likely to look, although I suppose as the last 24 hours demonstrates, it's always difficult to make assumptions about how the world will look, but they're making assumptions all of the time, and they're doing budget planning on the back of that. Clearly, the delay in the announcement of the settlement is a difficulty in that regard and may impact further down the line. In terms of what do we want most, I described it earlier as really two aspects to this. One is the level of cut, and the other is about the inflexibility in terms of the current budget. So the simple answer to that is we want maximum flexibility. That is the position. Scottish Government, for understandable reasons, will say that ring fencing is a thing of the past. Yes, but the reality is that an awful lot of our budget is fixed in particular ways. So actually, teacher numbers is simply another form of ring fencing, is the reality. And, you know, if capping of council tax isn't a form of a superseding judgment by government of a decision which ultimately should be taken on the basis of the democratic mandate, then I don't know what is. So flexibility is the key word as far as we are concerned.
Councillor McAveety.
Okay, thanks very much, Graham. Just to say that was on the blower earlier on to Eddie, so he sends his love and affection. Hope that's mutually beneficial as well.
Isn't that nice, Mr. Simpson?
It always is. It's always mutual.
Thank you. I mean, essentially, we walk to the principle, in terms of the SLGP figures, they're basically predicated on the kind of information we had for last year and the likely direction, which is contained, obviously, in the paper that Mr. Black's produced, which is in the committee papers, about direction of travel over the next 3 years. There's three caveats every time on this one. One is it depends what the input is at the Scottish end, because, for example, after the brouhaha last year, some other information and flexibility was introduced on the IGF funding, which allowed for some of that allocation to be redefined to help with some of the pressures on budgets itself. So we still don't know that until the Minister has to come in front of the Parliament to announce that, whenever the time frame is. I know that's something your committee and others have been having views on. The second issue also is just that we've through the work we've been doing, particularly in Glasgow, is to every fortnight be looking at the financial projections, because the other factors are, what do you then have to meet in the gap? The gap, I don't think, isn't really difficult to identify. It's about how do you meet the gap is the key challenge. So we've operated to that assumption that we're in this similar ballpark figure of a 4% cut for the Scottish local authorities, in some cases 5% for some councils. We just assume that we're getting an annual cut. That's just the kind of burden that we have in life in Glasgow. Thanks very much. But essentially what we want to do is work through that about what do we then do in terms of the balance of what you have in reserve, what you can generate via income, and what kind of transformation you have. And I think the key point that Michael has identified is the flexibility to allow us to get to that in years two and three by, in the sense, identifying the way in which we meet change services. Now, I'll be blunt with you, there will be cases, I think, in the next 3 years in Scotland that councils will have to sit down and think there might be some services they can no longer provide to the level that would be expected by any taxpayer. And that's a real challenge. I think anybody in government has to wake up to that. And if I hear again, this is kind of these unmodest changes that won't really impact on how we provide services, I think they're kidding themselves on. So we're up for that challenge. I've never shirked a difficult decision in my life in terms of the roles I've played at local government and in national government. But we need to be honest with each other about the parameters we're operating within. So that's something we need to deal with. In terms of decisions about flexibility of whether people wish to use or not use the potential for the 3% for local government, that's a balance that has to be determined locally, in my view, in relationship to what you think is acceptable locally or what you think is worthwhile locally. And there is a massive gap between that, as I said earlier, and the reality of the budgets that many local authorities, not just in SLGP, are facing.
I'll take Mr. Simpson back in a second. Any other witnesses want to add anything to that? Yes, Mr. Russell.
I suppose, reiterate and echo some of the earlier comments, and certainly from my point of view, the advice and guidance give to members at Renfrewshire, and I think most local authorities are same in terms of the development of medium-term financial planning, as well as the more immediate budgets moving forward into 17-18 that we're planning for. There is obviously a whole range of uncertainties that councils are dealing with in relation to that, both in the medium term but also the short term. So I think it's about recognising there's a continual process, and I think it's Councillor McAvity is indicating in Glasgow, and it will be very similar, I'm sure, across all councils, of continually refining what you're expecting the position to be the following year. I think one of the big challenges is trying to come to a view as early as possible of what that's going to be, and the position on grant is only one of those areas that feeds into that. But I think getting as early sight as possible of what that is and what conditions are associated with it is allows councils to help manage their budget process in a way which is I think important to say is sustainable in terms of service decisions, and not in a position, I think, particularly in 16-17, where there was the information and clarity around the budget being received very late, and placing councils in a position where they're having to set budgets at very short notice in terms of the clarity over the grant position.
Okay, thank you very much. Do you want to come back to any of that, Mr. Simpson?
So you mentioned the frustration about being told how many teachers to employ. Were there other areas that you'd like restrictions to be removed? Anyone?
The 3% is clearly a restriction. Clearly, councils can judge to freeze council tax or increase it. They should have latitude to do that. In relation to the health and social care monies, that should be routed directly to local authorities, would be the view of local authorities. In terms of others, I'll allow others to think of some, and I'm sure I can come back with some others. Attainment is another one. But I can say more about that, but I'll let others come in.
Okay. I think the people from Mr. Simpson has additional things that you would like flexibility on. And I think the things we've had on the record is the commitment to have to maintain teacher numbers and the capping of council tax at 3% are two things that were raised. It's an opportunity, really, for witnesses to put on the record any additional flexibilities they would like. And then I'll take Ruth Maguire in after that, if you're finished at this point.
Discretionary taxation would be another, Chair. Discretionary taxation would be another.
Chair, could I put in a couple of observations on? I'll set aside for the moment the discretion over local taxation. That's been discussed at an earlier point, and there's little point now returning to it. What I see is a degree of confusion between
prescriptive certainty aspired to by the centre, by which I mean the Scottish Government, to some extent the Scottish Parliament, and unpredictable flexibility that is being proposed. So, for example, the cap on teacher numbers strikes me as being a particularly heavy-handed exercise of central control. You know, once you get down to the level of what Argyll and Bute does and whether it has one or two teachers, the consequence of that, as I observe in some councils, not necessarily represented here, is rather, as we know, the consequence to have been in the what is now Police Scotland, which is staffing cuts are made in other aspects of the total workforce rather than uniformed officers. But I wanted to turn to the preschool education proposals, for example, where what I see is considerable confusion that makes planning ahead remarkably difficult. Because if there is an ambition and a wish to extend the hours available to those who have preschool children, in effect, given the pattern that operates, I think, throughout Scotland, as far as I can judge throughout Scotland, that requires a doubling of the preschool estate. There just aren't enough rooms to get wee bodies into morning and afternoon, because at the moment one lot go in the morning, the other lot go in the afternoon. And the response that is being debated and suggested, and whether modelled or not, I don't know, involves what seems to me the equivalent of a preschool voucher, which will be issued in, or could be issued in some ways. And I think that illustrates a broader conceptual discussion about how we are organising the provision of education before the statutory school age. So, and if I tie this into some of the earlier questions, I think then that has implications for the what I think is the very good work that Spice have put in front of you by colleagues of mine at Glasgow and Harriet Watt in terms of pro-rich and pro-poor services. I would challenge some of that. So, for example, arguably, secondary education, certainly in the upper years, is pro-rich is the wrong term, but it's certainly not pro-poor. When you have a very high proportion of kids in lower socioeconomic groups leaving school at 16, the money poured into sixth year and upper six is by no means pro-poor. Equally, in terms of how you judge that and how you deal with that, that's a long-term phenomenon. Nobody imagines we're going to close the attainment gap, which I guess we would all think is desirable, in anything less than 10 to 15 years. Because those kids who are not benefiting from education at the moment are already in the system. And turning that round is a long-term process. That's why I would argue for the kind of longer-term planning that George Black and the two councillors here have suggested to you. And I would have thought that modelling budgets... Now, if the gloomy reality, given the circumstances we face, is of a continuous reduction in central government to support to local government, which I think it is, certainly over the next 3 to 4 years, then government should have the courage to indicate that and say you should plan in 17, 18, and 18, 19, and 19, 20 to have a reduction of 1 to 1.5% in your budgets, rather than the modelling that is sometimes attempted, which is service directors are asked to, what would you do if your budget was reduced by 10%, what would you do next year? And invariably, they bring out the, used to be called shroud-waving options, so everybody goes, oh, no, we're not doing that. Whereas a sustained planning exercise would have a far smaller variation because what the Bank of England call fan graphs show that over the past X years, the variation has been actually, it's been continuous, but it's been relatively small year by year. I know there are exceptions, Michael, so
yeah, it's okay.
Don't rebut me on that one. My comment.
Okay. The question was, of course, in relation to flexibility, and thank you, that was very helpful. You mentioned preschool childcare commitments. Obviously, it was reported recently that in relation to monies made available, I think in the last 3 years for preschool childcare was £329 million to local authorities, but the expenditure was £189 million, which would be a shortfall of £140 million of the monies that were earmarked. Now, I have to say, I'm not criticising that or otherwise. I'm merely making the point does that show a flexibility that exists? Because you could make the political point and say, where's that money gone? You know, the Glasgow figure, Councillor McAveety, is given £15 million in the last financial year for childcare commitments, and £9.1 million was unspent, 60% of that provision. Now, that could just be good management of resources, and then you're redeploying that money elsewhere. But it's quite hard when you look at the numbers to pick some of that up. So is that an example of flexibility that already appears in the system, or if it wants to come back on in relation to those numbers?
I think I can't think of the right phrase. There is little evidence Scotland-wide that, based on our current model of preschool provision, that there are parents queuing up with children unable to get them in. They might like to have a different provision, and I think that part of our current debate that I find, I think will be very hard for any of you, and when I say you, I mean you and you too, to manage, is that we have overemphasized the available flexibility that is remotely possible. I've listened to people on the radio, I've read in BBC reports, parents talking about, well, you know, I'd really rather take my daughter to nursery school at 8 o'clock and pick her up at 4 p.m. Imagine if you said that about primary school. People would just say, well, that's not how the game works. You know, it's a different model. So I think that underspend is a reflection. I don't think it's a deliberate starvation of the system. But given the way we operate at the moment, and that is a broadly accepted way of operating across all Scotland's authorities, 3 hours, 10 minutes morning, 3 hours, 10 minutes afternoon, it's a mismatch between what we do under current regimes and how that is funded. But the gap between making the preschool day the same as the primary school day is a big one to bridge, and impossible to bridge in a year or 2 years, in my judgment. I may be wrong, unless these folk here have got prefab units.
I'm just trying to be slightly careful. I'm conscious we're not the Education Committee, with the local
Communities
Committee, and I'd love to have that conversation as well. It's something I'm passionate about, and keep the working partnership with the local authority on it as well. It was more about funds were identified, there was a budget line for them, and the last 3 years, £140 million of that budget line wasn't spent on that outcome, but the service was still delivered. That could just be good management of the system, and that money could be used elsewhere. We're looking at the budget, so it's a reasonable question to ask. Councillor Cook.
I think it's important to remember, of course, that assessment of the figures came heavily caveated. So that's the first thing I would say. The second thing I would say is, by its very nature, it goes back to the whole proposition about planning, long-term planning, medium-term planning. But there is time. It takes time to feed that resource into the system, is another aspect of this. A third aspect of it, I suggest, is that actually getting the two-year-olds into the provision which is directed towards them has been something of a challenge. So I think there are three propositions there which provide an element of challenge to a simple, easy conclusion in relation to the underspend, as you described it.
Okay, but the money was spent, I assume. The money was spent, it just wasn't spent on that. Ms. Flanagan.
Yes, I just wanted to add there as well that I think these figures do need to be challenged, and I think they are being looked at. And whilst there was seemed to be an overall underspend in that funding, we could equally give other examples. Whether that gave some flexibility, we could equally give other examples of areas of funding that were underfunded. For example, in Argyll and Bute Council, the Children and Young Persons Act, and certainly the through care and aftercare for us, has been severely underfunded. So there's lots of examples on the other side.
Yeah, and we don't have the government view on whether they would agree with that or not. I wasn't actually criticising the underspend, and please come back and challenge those figures and talk. The question was about flexibility and monies that were identified. Not all of it was spent, and local authorities were able to deploy it elsewhere. I was teasing up where the flexibilities exist. I'm indulging myself as chair. I'll move to another colleague, Mr. Gibson.
Yeah, thanks very much, Convener. Firstly, I would say that a lot of the evidence you've given today gives us a lot of food for thought in terms of the questions that myself and indeed our colleagues will be putting to Scottish ministers. I think there's a lot of really emotional and very passionate kind of you know, responses that we've had today. But I want to just touch on George Black's paper when he says, and I quote, "By giving such a high spending priority to health, adult social care and to police, it falls other areas of spend had to bear a greater proportionate share of the cuts." And the Scottish, you know, Dell actually suffered a real terms decrease of 1.4%. And I mean, that's really the elephant in the room here. Obviously, the Scottish Government has itself had a reduction in its allocation from Westminster. The proposal that was put forward at the Scottish election to raise taxes was rejected by the electorate. So really, although everyone, you know, from the local government side, and there's great sympathy in this committee for it, would like to see more money spent on local government, how do we actually square that circle? Because clearly political parties that are asking for more money to be spent in local government and to free up, you know, restrictions on teacher numbers will be the first to denounce the Scottish Government for, you know, switching money from the NHS to local government, and be the first to denounce the Scottish Government if they relax teacher numbers and teacher numbers fall. So how do we actually square that? And the other point I would like to raise at this moment as well is the funding formula. I've not really seen much about funding formulas. I remember we used to debate and discuss funding formulas ad nauseum. I mean, it's quite interesting that, for example, if we look at what's happened in Glasgow since devolution, for example, when we had the Liberal Labour coalition, Glasgow started off with about 130% of Scottish average in terms of capita resource. By the time the SNP came in, that was down to about 120% of the average, and it's now 114%. So there's been significant alterations in terms of how money's been allocated, but I've not really heard anything about that. So I just wonder if you can touch on some of those matters.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Gibson. Who'd like to come in on that one? Mr. Black.
Well, I touch on the point that was raised about the report. The simple point was just simply to make that there is a fixed cake, and that the more protection you give to priority services, the greater pressure it puts on other services. So that's a political choice. That was the only point I was trying to make there. There is no magic bullet as to how you can get through the next few years without addressing the severe financial pressures that that we face. And I mentioned earlier, and colleagues have raised again, but in terms of helping to manage that, if local authorities had three-year budgets, they're able to go into their transformation programmes with much more confidence that they've got the right envelope there, and are in a better position to explain to the public why they're going through that process. So my point is that we can't change the numbers, but we can actually make the process much more transparent to the public and easier for councils to implement.
Good point. I'll just let Councillor Koopman, I will take you in, but if it's specific to that response from
Mr. Black, specific then I'll take you to that point. Of course, it relies on the Scottish Government always knowing exactly where its budget's going to be allocated from Westminster year on year, and it doesn't always know that. So sometimes it can actually have a longer term budget, but not every year. Obviously, well, because of spending reviews and things.
So if I just reply, there will always be uncertainty about the overall envelope, but in the same way that, as you heard earlier, that councils don't get the heads up about what their grant is going to be and they go ahead with their financial planning, I can't see why the Scottish Government can't give indicative figures to councils to allow them to carry out that planning.
Okay. And Councillor Cook, you want to come in some of that?
Yeah, yes, please. I absolutely agree with what George Black has said about this. I'm in the happy position of not being a government minister, and nor am I a party politician. So I'm quite happy to make criticisms, I think, where they're appropriate on behalf of COSLA. Obviously, last year, there was actually a cash increase in relation to the money the Scottish Government received. That there could potentially be a cash increase this year. The important thing to bear in mind is that this is partly a consequence of what Scottish Government has done in terms of its own spending power. So actually, even though the resource may not be significantly different, and there can be argument about that, I would accept the position that there are pressures in the system there from a Scottish Government perspective. But the simple fact is they have reduced their spending power by the decisions that they have made. So, for example, if you have free tuition fees, if you have free prescriptions, if you have teacher numbers, if you have police numbers, these are all restrictions in the system, all of which require resource, which means that you have less flexibility in other places. Now, you may say to me, and this is perfectly legitimate, that you absolutely support each of those policy positions. But the simple consequence of that is that you have less flexibility in other places. So it's simply an augmentation, really, of the point that Mr. Black was making. And the simple fact is, as we've said earlier, if you lock up resource in relation to teacher numbers, then you simply can't deliver some of the things that you might want to deliver in terms of classroom support, classroom assistance, things of that nature.
Okay, thank you. Any other witnesses want to add to some of that? Do you want to come back on that,
yeah, Mr. Gibson? Surprised no one wants to talk about the funding formula. In terms of Councillor Cook's points, I understand what he's saying, but obviously these things were voted on by the electorate and there's a mandate for these decisions. I'm just wondering, in terms of the evidence that we took from the Accounts Commission, they actually expressed some concern that, given the pressures that local government actually faces, there's not enough sharing of knowledge, experience, best practice in terms of optimising service delivery, and that a service in one part of the country could be delivered for a significant different cost at the same quality, they ascertain. And so there is still much more room in the system, regardless of what the budget is, to deliver efficiencies, whether the budget's going up or down. Would you want to respond to that? Not specifically to you, Councillor Cook, but just the panel, anyone who wants to speak.
You'd indicated, Councillor...
If we were at police interview, I'd be nodding to say I agree with you. Mm. My observation is that various local authorities could gain, some do, and in some particular services there is a better record of cross-authority discussion about how do we do this and what is the consequence of that. It tends to be actually quite long established. So, for example, in what we now generally call consumer protection, environmental health, there are networks of sharing which are pretty fast and instantaneous, given the nature of the demands placed on those particular services. In other areas, I'm struck by the extent to which I wouldn't name organizations or people here, but I've heard people say, oh, no, we can't learn from them. You know, they're too small.
Thanks.
Too big, but I think there could be far more, and where it happens, and it is encouraged by COSLA, I'm aware of that, and Frank, I'm not sure about the polite term. Right. It appears to have proved beneficial.
Councillor McAfee, yes?
I mean, I think that has to be the direction of travel for local authorities, that where we can, part of the Christie Commission, was where to collaborate on a series of ways to try and maximise the best use of public resources, given that we are facing a combination of reduced budgets. Now, they're all political choices, whether it's at the UK or Scottish level. I mean, there's still many political choices that individual parliamentarians can make and bring pressure to their respective political parties to define that. So I don't think an absolute position today necessarily is the exact same position in a year's time. Politics has to be very fluid. What we will guarantee is SLGP have asked Fraser of Allender, who's report on the issues, the impact of the European Union vote has been welcomed by the government. We've asked Fraser of Allender to look at the grant distribution, so we're happy to share that with the committee in due course. I think we'll be of benefit to everybody in the final debate. I think the third big challenge for us over the next 3, 5, 10 years is that those authorities, because there's now a number of city deals across Scotland, about how do we use that partnership that's in the city deal structures with each other to try and combine and crack that big issue, convener, which is capital monies and revenue spend, and trying to make sure there's a kind of better partnership between those. And again, that's something that we want to develop further itself. Okay.
Okay, thank you, Councillor McAfee. Councillor Cook, did you want to come in?
Yes, really just, I think, adding to what others have said, I think Richard's absolutely right, that there is a process underway here. So some of these developments are clearly taking place in terms of shared best practice, shared service provision, things of that nature. Is there more to be done there? Absolutely, there's always more to be done. Efficiencies can be eked out of the system, but to believe that is the answer is to misunderstand the nature of the problem. I think that's the issue. The level of difficulty that we're now dealing with is of a completely different order from what we've seen before. The other thing is, I sometimes think that there is a trap in terms of how people perceive shared services. They routinely imagine that shared services is some kind of silver bullet. Yes, it has a part to play, but it plainly isn't a silver bullet, particularly in the context that we're talking about. And actually, one thing I think we've been seeking to prevail upon with Scottish Government, and I'd emphasise today, is that you need a whole systems approach here. This is not simply about public sector reform within the confines of local government. This needs to be looking at public sector reform right across the breadth of the public sector. And it's only when you engage on that scale will you be able to respond to the scale of the difficulty that we've got. Scottish Government, as we ourselves are keen to do, are constantly talking about communities. We need a much more locality-based premise underpinning our public sector reform approach. And I think that that is something that's really still in development. The tortured process, to some extent, of community planning partnerships is indicative, I think, of some of the challenges there.
Just before, yeah, I will take a final point, but Mr. Russell had said he wanted to come in, and then, yeah.
Thanks, Chair. I suppose a point to make for the committee, I think it's just a need to recognise that councils have obviously been on a journey, probably 2011-12, in delivering significant savings, and through that time, certainly at Renshire, and again, I think it will be very similar across other local authorities. A big drive to deliver efficiency savings through that process and protect the delivery of frontline services. And certainly, Renfrewshire participated in a Joseph Rowntie Foundation study that was published in March 2015, and that concluded, looking at the range of savings that Renshire had made, about 80% of those had been delivered through efficiencies, predominantly in back office, but also how we deliver frontline services. I think the point I would make is that savings journey has been significant, not just to deal with the reduction in grant over that period, to deal with the very significant cost pressures, but certainly for Renfrewshire has been the biggest driver of savings requirement. That challenge though is becoming more and more difficult to squeeze more and more efficiencies out of the system and to protect frontline services. And I think it's just about recognising. I think local government generally has got a very good track record in delivering efficiencies, and that's, I think, it's about recognising that that's becoming more difficult to do and more difficult to protect frontline services moving forward, and what we anticipate to be a further difficult period for local government.
Kenny, do you want to follow up with some of that?
Yeah, thanks very much. I mean, I personally am in favour of wholesale public sector reform, not just local government. More radical than the Scottish Government, I believe, are going to be proposing soon. But in terms of the issue, I wasn't just talking about shared services. I was also talking about how local authorities can look and learn from each other. Yes. For in-house services that may be entirely for one local authority, but seem to be delivered more effectively and efficiently elsewhere without any loss at the front line. And so I don't want you just to think I'm talking about shared services, which can be very complex and are not always appropriate.
Indeed, I absolutely...
In a second, but okay, it might be an appropriate time given the responsibility you have, Ms. Howitt, to take Eileen Howitt in to maybe answer some of that.
Thanks very much. I think really just to pick up the point around shared services and councils working together, I think there are some really good examples across the country where services are working together, but it's not necessarily a quick process to get there, and it doesn't always generate the efficiencies that you think it might do. What it does do is gives you some additional resilience across the country, but local government, speaking on behalf of Solis, very much up for doing things differently, and lots of good examples of transformation where councils are working together.
Okay, thank you, Councillor Cook.
Yeah,
I quite appreciate that you weren't simply referring to shared services. You're also right that it's extremely important that local authorities learn from the best practice of others. I sit on the Local Government Benchmarking Framework Board, and clearly benchmarking is an important aspect of how you drive change. So I've been here answering questions about the benchmarking process previously. The way I see benchmarking, quite simply, is it's principally a tool for managers and senior members in local authorities to understand the difference in service provision. Why is that local authority much more efficient in its deployment of that service than we are? Getting to understand that and then really delivering benefit as a result of that. I think that is one of the principal tools that benchmarking represents for us. And of course, what's extremely important here are what are called the family groups within the benchmarking process. So actually, as far as is possible, you're trying to compare like with like in terms of local authority, population density, topography, etc., etc. But it's an extremely useful tool. I think the inference that we draw from your question is there more to be done? Absolutely. I think we agree that there is more to be done, but I think what we're saying to you quite gently also is it's only a small part of the answer that we now need to find to the challenges that we face.
Any other witnesses? Any other witnesses would follow up on that?
Yeah. Can I just to respond to Mr. Gibson? I mean, obviously, you need to deal with the territory that's in front of you. So, for example, we're no longer, obviously, a landlord in terms of housing, which is a big decision. I know that Mr. Gibson was involved in sort of debate and discussion with myself over the years and previous roles that we had on the council. But we're now in a situation where we now are looking at a substantial landlord in the city, Glasgow Housing Association, who run the housing for half the tenants in the city. So we are now in a discussion with a serious joint venture development to try and maximise the resources, which also has a social benefit in terms of the apprenticeship programme that we've articulated for a long time, and combined with the real opportunity for the supported workplace to be one of the best, if it is not already one of the best in the UK. So by putting together two big institutions, the in-house building repairs team and the GHA, knowing that the GHA has got access to bonds and other things for capital investment, but then maximising opportunities to share expertise and knowledge, we're actually growing something that is of benefit to the public sector. So the massive challenge, I'll conclude on this point, in terms of the integrated joint boards, it'll take a long time to work through both the cultural differences between local government and health boards, which we all have encountered as elected members over the years, but equally, you know, the kind of challenges that local governments had to face about how to make savings is of a different style and proportion than perhaps has always been the case in health. So health is going to have to put back on the table, in my opinion, part of the debate that's about where do you find those savings and how do you find those savings. It's not just about exiting from a delivery of certain services, as sometimes can be the case. It's actually about demonstrating if you invest in early intervention strategies, which is clearly a priority of the government, how do we actually pull that together via the kind of partnerships, the public and quasi-private sector?
Okay, thank you. Anything you want to follow up on, Mr. Gibson, before we move on to the next?
I'm glad that Councillor McAvity touched on prevention, because I think that's very important. I think it's something we can't take our eyes off,
yeah,
you know, if we're going to be able to deliver.
Yeah. And I'll resist the temptation of listing other social housing providers in the north of the city that I know you are working in partnership with to deliver real,
this way,
hopefully real progress. Andy Whiteman.
Thank you, convener. I just want to ask a broad question about the balance of funding. Clearly, one or two of you have made reference to the fact that you'd like more flexibility about how much revenue councils can raise themselves, and I think we're coming off the back of a historic low on that, about 12% last year. The council tax multipliers will change, the caps now 3%, so there'll be a little bit of an increase. But I'm just wondering whether, in the context of all of this, whether there's any argument for the equivalent of the fiscal framework that the UK government and the Scottish government have negotiated, whereby you have a devolved administration with limited tax powers, which are being expanded, of course, but the relationship between how it deploys those tax powers and the impact that has on the block grant is subject to a set of rules that have been negotiated
Now, regardless of whether you agree with those rules or whatever, there is a framework in which both parties understand the implications of the actions of the other. Would there be any benefit in having a similar framework for local governments so that whether you agree or disagree with the actions of government and how much money it gives you or whatever, at least you know what the implications will be in future?
On that particular question, I note our council colleagues have brought experts with them in relation to helping with that.
That one, isn't it? You
perhaps
know,
not on
that
issue, though.
Can I just say, too, I mean, for part of the kind of theatre of debate, we used to have parity of esteem debates in the Parliament between local government and national government, and also we had a historic concordat, which was often a feature of the First Minister's question debates when I was here in a previous role. I mean, I think the key element for us as councils is that, you know, my personal view on this in terms of the experience that I've had both at local government and ministerial positions is that when we had the Arbuthnot review on health spend, that was capable of being done, even though there was some anguish about some of it, because it was broadly within growth criteria in terms of the resources were broadly going up. The challenge for us right now is because of the nature of public spending and the likely figures that we've identified already in the submissions, there's a real shift on that, and can we get ever to the levels of, you know, partnership where there's a level of figures of accountability that councils have a greater capacity to raise at their local level compared to the direction of the national government. That, I mean, that's a good discussion for tutorials and seminars. I don't know if it's shifting much in terms of the actual political process, because it seems to be quite glacial in the last few years in terms of how we actually shift those things. So my view would be, I'd much prefer to have, as we were talking about earlier, a much clearer picture around indicative figures, because we're all big boys and girls. We can cope with hard decisions and hard realities, but just give us a bit of time and space to work with you. So any recommendation I think that could come from here, from the committee, would be, let's explore, find the territory to have that, rather than the kind of, you know, shouting over the garden fence at each other about who's left some stuff in their garden compared to anybody else.
Councillor Cook?
Thanks very much. I think it's a good question, really, about how you might get greater proportionality and less arbitrariness in terms of the decision-making, in terms of how the system currently works. So, for example, in terms of the Commission on Strengthening Local Democracy, which was something that COSLA commissioned, they had a look at the trajectory of local government revenue raising and expenditure over the course of time. There's a clear picture in Scotland historically, which accelerated after the Second World War, which I know that you'll be aware of, but quite simply, the level of revenue spent by local authorities, which they themselves raised, has dropped massively. So the most recent commission in relation to local taxation set up by Scottish Government clearly looked at the vexed issue of council tax. Council tax provides round about 11%, or that was the position certainly at the time that commission reported, 11% of the revenue spent by local authorities. The aspiration in the Commission on Strengthening Local Democracy was actually to see much greater financial autonomy on the part of local government, recognising its democratic mandate, and its aspiration was to see something moving much more closely to a 50-50 balance in terms of grant revenue and raised revenue, in terms of local authorities having the autonomy to do that. So, in answer quite simply to the question, would some kind of framework help here? I think it would. It would certainly assist, as Frank has intimated, I think, with things like parity of esteem. The simple reality, and I this will sound slightly cheeky, but the simple reality as matters stand, all of the things that we're currently looking at are matters of decision essentially by others, in which we are simply the respondent. That is true for the most part, and I think the view of the Commission on Strengthening Local Democracy, which embraced more than simply local government, obviously, it embraced a range of stakeholders across Civic Scotland, was to say, actually, we need to look at this. We need a much better balance in relation to these things. And that democratic mandate at local level is important, but it needs to be accountable and it needs to be autonomous to some extent. There will always need to be some balance in the system afforded by central grant to take out some of the obvious inequalities, but actually that's something where we can create a much better model to approach these issues.
My apologies.
As you know, there was a broad proposal by the Scottish Government to assign a proportion of income tax revenues to local government based on the tax take. And if that proposal was to be taken forward, it would seem to me that it's important that local authorities are given the powers to stimulate economic growth in their area to increase the tax take. And at the moment, some of these powers will lie with agencies like Scottish Enterprise and Skills Development Scotland. So if there was to be a proposal as outlined by the Scottish Government, I think there's implications as to whether some of the powers held by these organisations should flow down, not necessarily to individual authorities, but perhaps to groups of authorities, because a lot of the economic development initiatives won't be peculiar or won't be unique to one council geographical area, but will be wider, for example, the Clyde Valley. So it may be more appropriate to look at the powers being organised on that basis.
Okay, now I'm going to give Mr. Whiteman the opportunity to come back if he wishes, and I do need to move on because Ruth McGrath has been very patient. Andy. Yeah. Are you finished? Yep. Ruth McGrath.
Okay, thank you, Convener. We received written evidence on reserves, and I'm just keen to hear a little bit more from the panel about what appropriate levels of reserves would be for local authorities. Obviously, they vary greatly. And also how those reserves could be utilised to support, whether it's savings or changes.
Okay, who'd like to...
If it's appropriate, the Director of Finance could be best to do that. I mean, I've got a view of what you do with reserves, but maybe a later technical answer on this would be quite useful.
We did not want you to speak, Ms. Johnson. Just we were trying to give due place to the elected representatives, of course. Morag Johnson.
No, thank you, Chair. I think a couple of points on reserves. I mean, certainly in Glasgow's history, we have tried to avoid using reserves as a way to meet our revenue expenditure for reasons that I'm sure are obvious to committee in terms of sustainability. I think what has happened, though, most recently, and certainly in the 16-17 budget, was that the scale of reduction, which I think was unexpected at the level that was received, did result in the council having to look to its reserves because it is statutorily obliged to set a budget before the 8th of March, and therefore to try and extend our transformation programme and our savings in such a short period of time just meant that wasn't possible, and we actually had to use some one-offs in 16-17 in order to allow us to set our budget and allow our transformation programme to catch up. I think the second thing around reserves is just simply the scale of transformation that we are having to undertake. And I think it was in Mr. Black's paper where he recognised that these things don't happen quickly. They can take 2 to 3 years and there can be some uncertainty. And actually, I think reserves are much more important now in terms of underpinning those level of transformation, because we do know that there can be risks in delivery in these things, and our reserves are important to us just to allow us to, again, to bridge that gap if things like technology takes longer than anticipated to implement.
That's helpful, thank you. Anyone else want to come in relation to that? Sorry, Mr. Russell.
Yeah. I would just, to a large extent, echo what Morag just said. Certainly at Renfrewshire, we've got a financial planning principle of not relying on reserves, if at all possible, to underpin our budget. Clearly, it's not a sustainable position over the medium term. They are, however, an important financial planning tool over the medium term to support change, support the delivery of projects that do span a number of years in terms of being able to earmark resources to then support the delivery of those projects and initiatives over a medium term period. And I think there's often difficulties in messaging that with the public and I think in the media and how that's played out in relation to the level of reserves that councils sometimes hold. Certainly in Renfrewshire, the unallocated reserves, if you like, which are there to help manage risks and unforeseen risks that may emerge are retained at less than 2% of the council's budget, so that they are held at a prudent but minimal level. And I think moving forward, it's important to recognise that role of reserves and in terms of supporting budget and supporting addressing the financial challenge on a sustainable basis, reserves are certainly not the answer.
Anyone want to add anything in relation to the use of reserves?
Just again, I think it's an echo of what's already been said. So the Scottish Borders Council is my council, exactly the same kind of process as has been described. So essentially, the use of reserves in order or as part of a pre-planned programme of trying to deliver transformation in certain areas. In terms of how we construct our reserve, possibly a slight difference from some other councils in relation to that, which it's maybe worth remarking on in part. Previously, we used to do it on the basis of 2% of our revenue spend. We've moved to a position which is basically an assessment of total risk and the likelihood of risk accrual, and then worked out how much resource we need to set aside in order to deal with that. So it's a slightly different approach. But I think, as everybody has said, really the underlying proposition here is you can use this stuff, and actually the recent rise in reserve positions I think is indicative of that, but it's not ultimately sustainable. You can only spend the money once.
So Kirsty Flanagan and Councillor McAfee have indicated the wish to add to this, and Ruth, I'll take you back in to follow up on some of that if you want. Kirsty Flanagan.
Yeah, like others have indicated, we wouldn't advocate the use of reserves to support savings or ongoing expenditure, because it can only be used once. But it's worth pointing out that we've had to use it to support the savings in terms of paying for redundancy costs, and that is depleting our use of reserves. We also have set aside our reserves to support the economy in Argyll and Bute. That's our main priority, is trying to boost the economy, and we have put significant investment into to regenerate our area, and we also indeed use it for transformation. But levels of reserves generally, I think, are reducing, and as we're moving into a time of continued decline in the Scottish Government funding, then I think it's becoming more and more difficult what to use that reserves for, because you may want to keep it for risk purposes. Last year we increased our reserves from 1.5% to 2%, and that was based on the risk. But like other authorities say, we set it based on our own criteria in our own area.
Councillor McAfee.
I think the central theme that we would have is that, you know, this is a structural issue, and reserves are there for kind of crisis situations or periods of uncertainty, so we shouldn't confuse the two. Now, I'm only saying that because Morag's absolutely rigorous whenever politicians are asking about what's the reserve figure at the moment. So she's absolutely, I wanted her to speak there earlier because she's absolutely scrupulous at reminding you that, and obviously she learned at the altar of George Black in respect to that, about making sure that the city councillors understand the reality of financial frameworks. But two things I would say is, you know, my mother used to say to me, you wouldn't run a menage like this, so you really don't want to do a situation around reserves. It's about the structural debate you need to have and we need to have with you in partnership to address how do we actually get a level of resources in that meet the demand, because what's not been overstated yet today is that there are emerging demands in terms of the nature of our society that has an impact on what we do, and there are expectations in terms of wages and also the commitment that we've all made to the living wage that will be the expected norm in the public sector, and all those have consequences in terms of what we spend the money on.
Okay, and Councillor McAfee, just for those watching proceedings that might not know, Mr Black's former job as Chief Executive of Glasgow City Council. I'm not sure if he does or doesn't have an altar. Perhaps he could confirm that after today's meeting, but just put that on the record for those watching. Ruth Maguire.
That was interesting.
I know that Mr. Gibson wanted to follow up on some of that.
So, George is a bit like Clark Kent, actually, where he takes off his moustache, you know, you don't realise it's George Black. No, it's just a point. I mean, obviously, the reserves are now about $1.89 billion in Scotland, and it's counterintuitive that at a time when council budgets are reducing, reserves have increased by 50% in the last 5 years, and indeed, Kirsty Flanagan talked about increasing Argyll and Buttes. So, you know, it almost seems as if the more pressure on local government, the more the reserves seem to increase, and that just seemed a bit odd. And also, when you're arguing for additional resources from Scottish Government, it does give Scottish Government a lever to say, but look at the size of reserves. And what's interesting is, if every council had the same proportional reserves, you would understand the argument. But we've seen figures which are huge differential across Scottish local government. And so one might say, well, one local authority's got, you know, 25% reserves, another may have 9% reserves. So it becomes a difficult one, I think, from your perspective to really argue when you realise there's no consensus on in level of reserves. What's the optimum level of reserves? And in what circumstances these might be drawn down in a rainy day?
Okay. Now we'll take Maura Johnson back in to clarify some of the matters around reserves.
Yeah. Chair, if it's helpful, I can maybe speak about Glasgow's position, because we actually did make quite a big contribution to our reserves in 2015-16. But I think that was absolutely in recognition that we started some of our transformation programmes early, earlier than this time last year, I suppose, in anticipation of what the settlement would be in 16-17. And so actually what we had were some unanticipated benefits when we set our budget for 15-16, and that is certainly why in Glasgow's case the level of reserves increased. As I've indicated, you know, they will be getting used from now on. And the only other point I would make as well is sometimes when reserves are reported, it's the difference between earmarked reserves and unearmarked reserves. And certainly in Glasgow's case, you know, certainly in the lead up, for example, to the Commonwealth Games, and now in the lead up to the European Championships, we use reserves as a way, if you like, to hold the money that we are contributing to those types of events as well. And sometimes that can skew the figures.
Thank you very much. Councillor Cook, did you want to...
Essentially, what I was going to say is, I think what's already been said to you is there's a big difference between earmarked reserves and unallocated reserves. So my local authority, I can't remember the figures offhand, I don't have the financial plan with me, but if you look at the total reserve, it's significantly greater than the unallocated element. The unallocated element is something like £6 to £7 million. But of course, even in terms of what local authorities include within the overall reserve head, may be slightly different actually in terms of what they batch up as all of those propositions. So within our reserve, you'll have things like the capital fund, you'll have a fund which deals with early retirement, voluntary severance, redundancy, things of that nature. So all of these things are bracketed up. And in terms, I think, of some of the general information that's put out, what you see is the headline figure, you think, my God, that's gone up astronomically. But actually, in terms of underlying unallocated reserves, which are there to deal with shocks and contingencies, I think we're in a slightly different position. It is true, however, I think that local authorities are planning ahead. So actually, part of the thought process, which I'm sure underpins some of the increase that you're looking at, is the thinking about reduction in headcount. How are you going to fund that? You need to set aside monies to do that. Where are you going to place that? It might sit in the reserve. They're looking at other shocks to the system. And they may be planning, as we've described earlier, in relation to the careful use of some reserve to underpin elements of revenue until they can create greater turnaround in their skin. So there's a whole series of things here, and I think it's a much more complex picture than simply looking at headline reserves.
Okay, thank you very much. Do you want to come back into any of that? Okay, supplementary from Alexander Stewart, and then we'll move on to Mr. Simpson.
Thank you, convener. Reserves are really very much a part of the sort of financial and strategic planning that any local authority goes into. But the whole aspect of the way that local government is treated by national government can sometimes create that confusion. It can create that disruption that you have to then think about putting more aside, because without having that, there's an uncertainty that continues to grow. So would that be another reason that would be used and could be moved forward because of that uncertainty and because of that disruption that may be created?
I think there are two things I would say to that. Is clearly matters of unpredictability or unheralded decision-making or late decision-making impacts on the abilities of local authorities to plan ahead. Not being able to plan ahead is injurious to service provision and supporting those communities who are important to Scottish Government and to us. So I think there are a series of challenges in relation to that. The other aspect of your question? Let me think a bit further about the question. I'll let someone else come in.
Thank you.
Would anyone else like to come in? It's not obligatory, but, you know. Okay, well, we might. If you want to come back in later, Councillor Cook, that's fine. We'll move on.
Thought in my head, but it'll come back to me.
It happens to me all the time. Don't worry about that.
It's a sign of age.
Mr. Simpson.
Thank you. So we heard earlier that South Lanarkshire Council are going to freeze council tax. They're not choosing to use the option of increasing it by up to 3%. Do we have any feeling on what other councils are going to do? I'm looking at you, Councillor McAveety. You lead a council, but we've got representatives from both the main council groups here.
As an MSP for Glasgow, if you wanted to give an exclusive
I have a very detailed discussion with members of the administration before I arrive at that conclusion. Okay.
Safe answer to that is really to say the councils are waiting to see what the settlement is before they make an ultimate judgment in relation to that. I think the slightly challenging proposition rhetorically is if we are saying that the financial context is challenging, not exploiting even that marginal opportunity that we have afforded by the additional 3% does seem slightly curious, but these things need to be looked in the round. And actually, what I would absolutely defend to the hilt is the ability of all local authorities to make the judgment themselves based on the considerations that they regard as appropriate. So I wouldn't denigrate any council for deciding that it's going to freeze council tax. It makes that judgment. It will then be measured by that judgment ultimately, and that's how it should be. If someone else chooses to increase it, then that's a matter which they can put to the democratic vote and they can get a response back in relation to that. Mm. I think the important aspect of this is having the freedom locally to make the decision and then being accountable for it.
Okay. Before I ask another question, colleagues, anyone would like to come in and move on? Okay, well, I'm going to briefly, Mr. Gibson.
No, I'm just thinking out loud here. I'm just thinking it's curious that South Lanarkshire have actually done this before there's any indication of the settlement. And, you know, and Scottish ministers might think, well, maybe local government isn't doing so badly if a decision like that can be made. I don't think it's been very helpful to the process, personally.
Member authorities in the SLGP, just say, I think that the leader of South Lanarkshire could quite rightly say that he's only fulfilling a manifesto commitment, which is maybe something members of the government would consider sometimes as well.
And I suspect without going down that road, we might have come full circle, Councillor McAveety. We started off the questioning where we were probing information in relation to the £250 million in a Health and Social Care Integration Fund, which will help pressures in terms of wages at a local authority level, and it will help pressures in social work. And we are trying to track some of that because it's not reflected in the revenue settlement. I will take you in, Councillor Cook. We also wanted to track the flexibility that local authorities had, which is why we asked you about the £140 million underspend in 3 years in relation to monies given to you by the Scottish Government in relation to fill your commitments in childcare that you held on to and then used elsewhere within local government. And we were asking you about increasing reserves. We know times, despite all that, we still know times are challenging for local authorities. Of course we do, but there's always a feeling for, I used to sit in this committee back in 2007, back in the day, a long time ago now, but there's always a feeling that local authorities put the worst case scenario to committees like this, and governments perhaps put the best case scenario to committees like this. What we're trying to do is get beneath some of the numbers to scrutinise the numbers irrespective of what the budget settlement is. So my appeal for you to me would be, when we're looking to scrutinise the budget settlement, yes, that revenue grant, yes, the challenges for local authorities, but also those other monies that are coming into the system but not in control of local authorities that you think we should be looking at. And of course, you might want to say local authorities should or should not have those, but we need to know where those pots of cash are. And the £100 million attainment fund was cited by Councillor Cook. I've mentioned the £250 million health and social care integration fund, which will meet needs in local authority areas, but not in control of local authorities. So I would ask you, are there other pots of cash out there that you think we should be looking at, we should be examining, and we should be scrutinising as part of our budget scrutiny? Councillor Cook.
Yes, a couple of points I wanted to come back in. Remembering the other point that I was going to make, because it's now relevant, actually, right. Again, is actually local authorities are really good at this stuff. We say constantly that the situation is seriously calamitous, but local authorities are extremely good at eking out a position in relation to the most challenging circumstances. And I think you need to understand that. I'm sure you do understand that. So, you know, the number of times I've seen a rhetorical approach from local authorities saying, most challenging ever budget. And then actually, because local authorities have done their damnedest to mitigate the effects of that on their communities, the public reaction has been comparatively light. That applies in relation to a whole series of circumstances, I think, not least in relation to job losses. So there is an assessment, certainly by the trade union since 2011, that of the 50,000 jobs lost in the public sector in Scotland, 40,000 of those have gone out of local government. There's obviously a sharp contrast there with the situation in the Scottish Government controlled health service, where different rules apply in relation to compulsory redundancy. But what I can absolutely say, I'm sure across the country, every one of those 32 local authorities is absolutely determined, as far as they possibly can, to guard against effects like the loss of headcount as far as they reasonably can, particularly where that's going to have a negative socio-economic impact in terms of that local area. The other thing I wanted to come on to really was just what you were saying about the living wage and the attenuation of wage pressures. I take it this is understood, but obviously the attenuation provided by the 125 million is only in relation to adult social work staff. It's not across the board. So that's where that money was directed, and I think it's important to recognise that. So we've got cost pressures, you know, we've got wage inflation, we've got pension pressures in relation to teaching, we've got national insurance changes, we've got things like the apprenticeship levy bowling down the track to us. These are general pressures across the board, not simply in relation to one discrete element of the cake.
I'm delighted you remembered the point you were going to make earlier on. You had the chance to put that on the record. It was a genuine appeal, because we're about to close this particular evidence session. Are there any other monies that you think we should be looking at that are swirling about within your local authority areas that you don't have control or direction necessarily over as much as you'd want to, that we should be looking at as part of this budget scrutiny? There's not, you can perhaps write to us later and let us know in relation to that, because one of the key themes of our budget scrutiny is to look at the overall expenditure in a local authority area and who directs that. And that may lead to local authorities saying, no, we should have that cash, we should be directing it. Who knows where it will lead, but we want to scrutinise it, because that's our job as a committee. So, Mr Cook, did you want to...
I trust I'm not drawing the wrong inference here, but I think the message from us today is loud and clear. Yes, there may be advantages to be derived from certain funds that are allocated which are not sucked up by the total cost associated with delivering those services. But actually, that's a marginal part of the picture that we're dealing with. The picture, broadly speaking, is one of significant financial challenge, and even that's euphemistic. Okay, so as far as we're concerned, yes, you've heard the rhetoric before, but this is certainly the most challenging set of circumstances that we're going into. If you think there are lots of efficiencies to be derived from local government services as currently configured. I don't challenge the proposition there are efficiencies there, but the level of efficiency that we can eke out of the system is not commensurate with the level of challenge that we face. And I think we want the committee to hear that.
I think we've heard it loud and clear, and I think you've put it on the record earlier. That's good that you've reinforced that. Please do. Councillor McAfee, did you want to come in?
I mean, obviously in the short to medium term, that central argument is what both SLGP and obviously Councillor wish to indicate. That is, you know, if we're talking about elephants in the room, there's a structural issue of the allocation of budget, which you need to interrogate as members of the Parliament. The second issue, for example, is there was a review being undertaken on the skills agenda. Now, I was then inspecting that would have a genuine, serious engagement with local government. I'm surprised it seems to have not been that situation as it's starting to unravel. But I'll give you a good example of where I think the medium to long term there's real potential, is that if we are developing city deals where the economy is wider than, say the city deal that we have with our seven other partner authorities, the real capacity then to have this proliferation of skills strategies that are all over the public sector and the private sector, utilising the relationship via city region. We should be looking at almost like city regional approaches to skills development that then tie in essentially to the differences in the Scottish economy, because the challenges in the west of Scotland, whilst there's a lot of similarities across the whole country, there are very distinctive characteristics. So in terms of SLGP, clearly Aberdeen, one of our partner authorities, is having to face up to the new challenge of what's happening to the carbon industry in the northeast of Scotland, and therefore they need to try and have a new way of looking at their wider economy, because they've had an economy that's been framed and shaped by the benefits of oil and gas. And equally, in terms of the Greater Glasgow and the west of Scotland, member authorities in the city deal, of which Renfrewshire and South Lanarkshire are part of, that we genuinely see a kind of willingness to open up that debate that might help the public expenditure issue in the future, but also make sure we're maximising the opportunities through the kind of partnerships we're going to have to help that. So I think those are the kind of areas around that. If there are other issues that can come to mind over the next period, we'll take the invitation up and we'll certainly respond back to you.
Okay. I think that's very helpful. It's also a very helpful place to end it, Councillor McAvity, because the city deal clearly has various tiers of government working in partnership to deliver that, and that's a good point. But please do contact us after this meeting and write to us with any additional information that you want to provide us with. So can I thank all the witnesses for the session this morning. That concludes agenda item 1. We now move to agenda item 2, consideration of evidence, and that will be in private. So thank you, everyone. Thank you.